Good evening, everybody. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager here at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. Here in Seattle, these are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to tonight's program with Angela Garbes and Melissa Miranda, which is presented in partnership with Elliott Bay Book Company and the Wing Luke Museum. We're grateful to our author series sponsor. Yeah, let's just get it going tonight. We're grateful to our author series sponsor, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and to the Seattle Times for their generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I'd like to give a big hello and welcome to all of our attendees here at Central Library and also watching the live stream. I have just a few announcements before we get started. First, I just wanted to mention that Angela's book, Essential Labor, was chosen by the library as a peak pick, which is our collection of popular high interest titles. Yeah, exactly. I was just going to say the books are immediately available to readers with no holds and no wait. And I saw that you put that out on your social today as well. I love it. I also wanted to mention we have a few other events that are coming up, and just specifically on this Thursday, May 19th, the wonderful Claudia Castro Luna will be here to celebrate the release of her newest poetry collection. And I'm sure that Elliott Bay Books has more information about that event at their table. Elliott Bay also have copies of Angela's books. So if you're here with us tonight in person, they have copies at the table to your right. And if you're watching online, you can find Angela's books at their website, elliottbaybook.com. And I'll be popping direct links to her books in the chat during the event. Angela will be signing books after the event, and we're requesting that folks are masked in the signing line afterward for everybody's safety. For folks here in person, I mentioned if you need to exit the auditorium during the event, there's a door just there to your right. The building is officially closed, as you may have noticed, but the restrooms are open for the duration of the event. After tonight's conversation, there will be time for questions from the audience. Folks here in person can write your questions on the little index cards that I was handing out as you came in, and I'll collect them at the end of the event. And if you're watching online, you can ask your question at any time by writing it in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen, and we'll be interspersing those into the Q&A as well. And finally, we're interested in hearing from you. Toward the close of the event, I'll be posting a link to a survey in the chat, and we'll also collect the paper surveys that I was handing out as folks leave. Now I am delighted to welcome our speakers. Hooray. Angela Garbes is the author of Like a Mother, an NPR Best Book of the Year and finalist for the Washington State Book Award in Nonfiction. Her work has appeared in the New York Times, The Cut, New York, Bon Appetit, and featured on NPR's Fresh Air. She also co-hosts The Double Shift, an acclaimed podcast challenging the status quo of motherhood in America. Angela will appear in conversation with Melissa Miranda. Melissa is the chef slash owner of Musong, a Filipino restaurant that opened in Seattle's Beacon Hill neighborhood in January 2020. Melissa attended culinary school and worked in kitchens in Florence, Italy, before cooking for 2 years in New York City. After returning to Seattle, she worked as a sous chef at Bar del Corso while developing Musong. At Musong, she works with her team to craft dishes inspired by childhood memories. Musong also runs a not-for-profit, no-questions-asked free meal program through their community kitchen, as well as a children's cooking program called Musong Little Wildcats. Melissa's committed to making Musong not just a traditional restaurant, but a community space that aims to educate the broader public about Filipino food and culture. Please help me welcome Angela Garbes and Melissa Miranda, and first, we're going to hear from Angela reading from the book, and I think you're going to come to the podium, right? Okay. Yeah, all the behind the scenes.
That mic, it's muted. Yeah. Hi. Thank you all for being here. I had to stop myself from looking at every single face and being like, Hey, my whole family is here. So many people I love are here. My community is here. Thanks for showing out. I see maple moms. I see former coworkers. I see the people I love to dance with. So many wonderful people. So I kind of, the section I'm going to read is inspired by that. I just think community and channeling our care energy to places besides our home into the outside world are, oh, hi, are how we are going to survive. It's how we've been surviving. So that's where I'm going to start. And I'm going to stop talking, and then Melissa and I will get into a lot of different things. I'm just going to kind of jump in here in the middle of a chapter. So if it feels like an abrupt start, it is. Also, hi, and hi, baby Mac. I want to welcome our youngest audience member, Mac White. All right. Central to pre-colonial Philippine culture is bayanihan, which means communal solidarity. Its roots lie in the shared labor of farming, child rearing, house building, and house moving. Throughout Philippine folk art, you'll find a recurring image of a group of people moving a nipa hut, hoisted on bamboo sticks, a la Cleopatra being carried on a litter. In a tropical monsoon-heavy climate, flooding is not uncommon. Through bayanihan, a community could relocate a family by lifting the home and moving it to higher ground. Historian Louis Francia cites the Banawe rice terraces, which many Filipinos like me were raised to proudly call the eighth wonder of the world, built by the Ifugao people of northern Luzon as an enduring example of bayanihan. Carved out of the rock of the Cordillera Mountains at treacherous heights and angles, the terraces, which are still in use today, required tremendous coordination and effort to build. Organizing the labor, building up the patties, and devising the placement of rocks and irrigation canals were daunting challenges that required a tight, cohesive, and efficient social structure, he writes. In modern American culture, that sort of tight-knit community seems increasingly rare. For centuries, extended personal networks have been eroded, replaced with privatized jobs and small, isolated kin units. A lack of shared responsibility and interconnectedness makes it difficult to find solutions for needs more easily addressed in community, such as childcare, meal preparation, and household maintenance. It leads to isolation and an every family for themselves mentality. It leaves parents feeling common domestic strains as personal problems rather than structural ones. Neoliberal family life has turned the very idea of accountability to others into a dreadful burden, writes sociologist Catherine Jeezer Morton. If you're looking to optimize your schedule for maximum efficiency, having to pause and account for someone else's pace and needs, someone who isn't even related to you, throws a spanner in the works. I'm not trying to romanticize or fetishize the past, but the simple fact is that for centuries throughout the world, we lived communally. Having individual families siloed off from one another behind fences, out of sight and out of mind, is a relatively recent social structure that we accept. This model has been forced upon us at a steep cost to parents and families. What would it take to go back? Not go back in time, but to really look back, understand other cultures, cultures under threat of erasure, cultures subjected to force and exploitation, resilient cultures that continue to thrive despite colonization, and glean wisdom from them. We don't need to recreate social structures wholesale, bless you, but we could learn more communal aspects of living, use them to rethink and reshape American life. I suspect that most of us find ourselves wanting more support, more people to share the load, more time with blood and chosen family. COVID-19 has no doubt intensified these desires, but if we're being honest, they existed long before the pandemic. When you find yourself marooned in that feeling of lack, think of William McKinley. I should explain. So William McKinley was the president of the United States when America took the Philippines as a colony. And they assumed control under something that they called benevolent assimilation. Think of forced assimilation into a culture of individualism, no matter how benevolent it may seem. It isn't just colonized people who were coerced into adopting an isolated way of life. It's all Americans. Like so many others, my family's survival relies more than ever on community, or to put it in the dated language of the pandemic, our pod. While we all count on distance from others to stay safe, over time, we've also learned that our mental and emotional health deteriorates without others to talk, play, share a meal, and unwind with. I was raised by immigrants who came to America with very little and worked their way into the middle class. Hi, Mom and Dad. I love you. It feels shameful to admit that I don't have the desire to hustle up that same ladder. But that ambition has never existed in me, no matter how much or how long I hoped it would show up. My daughters will have fewer financial resources than I did, but I already know I have given them more of a sense of self and confidence and community than my parents, who spent years just surviving, were able to give me. Better or worse hardly feel like the appropriate ways to measure these versions of family, but I know that I prefer the latter for my children. Noli and Lagaya, hi, know how to spin a dreidel and swap coins accordingly. They know more about Jewish culture than I did until I was 19, when my freshman college roommate gave me a crash course over tins of hamantaschen sent by her mother. They have Filipinx classmates and brown-skinned teachers. For the earliest years of their lives, their authority figures were mostly women who spoke English as a second language. As of now, we have absolutely no idea how we would pay for orthodontia or their college educations if they decide to go. But right now, they have more than 10 grown-ups in their life whom they love and trust, who see them fully, and whom I would let discipline them without a thought. How can we show our children that even as social circles shrink, it is also possible to deepen dependence on family, neighbors, and even strangers? How can we instill the idea that all people are our people? The American dream is based on the idea that freedom is about being unburdened from others, having the power to do whatever we want, whenever we want. It is deeply individualistic. But as activist Mia Birdsong explains in her book, How We Show Up, Reclaiming Family, Friendship, and Community, there is an older understanding of freedom that we must rediscover. The words free and friend are derived from the Indo-European Freya, which means beloved. Freedom, Birdsong writes, was originally the idea that together we can ensure that we have all the things we need: love, food, shelter, safety. Freedom is not an individual effort, but a collective one. Being free, writes Birdsong, is achieved through being connected. Building relationships can be messy and awkward. Interdependence requires real communication, empathy, sorting through calendars and logistics. It means misunderstandings, problem solving, asking and listening, not just popping in and dropping off, but sometimes lingering and running late. But I'll take pulling someone through my doorway so we can finish a conversation about our children's conflict because the oven timer is going off and I don't want to burn the potatoes, over meaningless small talk accompanied by warm wine and a sad fruit platter any day. I've grown to love the casual, chaotic negotiations required of interdependence. My time and attention are not so precious, then I cannot give them to another child, another adult, another family. They can be given freely because, it turns out, I have so much to give. A few months ago, I brought my older daughter over to the Chase Chens. The Chase Chens are our co-family who we survived the pandemic because of, and they're here tonight, to sort through the big clothes closet. Every few months, when the children are about to bust out of their clothes, they haul out a bunch of plastic bins filled with hand-me-downs from various friends and neighbors and size up. Becca had invited us to join, I suspect because she had noticed that most of my girls' pants had holes on the knees and nearly threadbare seats through which you could definitely see their patterned underwear. Noli and I made a loaf of banana bread as a gesture of thanks. John Doe greeted us at their door with a baking dish, our baking dish, which last week had held a lasagna we'd given them, filled with glowing mangoes. A friend of ours, well, it's a long story, but basically it's like a mango farm and they send us boxes every year, he explained. We traded mangoes for still warm banana bread. Noli's interest in sorting through clothes lasted just a few minutes, so she took off to play with Ruth. Becca had recently undergone knee surgery, so she lay on the bottom bunk bed and we chatted as I picked through little striped pants, kitty cat dresses, and unicorn socks. A car pulled up outside the house. It was another friend of ours, Jen, who's also here tonight, and her son, Teo. Jen had offered to bring dinner one night while Becca recovered from surgery. I was happy to see that she had brought arroscaldo, a gingery Filipino rice porridge and perfect convalescence food. We all hung out on the patio for a while, catching up as our three big kids ran around. Soon there was a lot of yelling, and there appeared Lagaya, fresh from preschool and carrying a mini cupcake, face covered in chocolate. Sunny was behind her in hot pursuit, but Lagaya refused to share. We grown-ups chatted for a little while longer, raising our own voices above the ambient noise of children screaming. When I finally loaded my children into the car, plus three shopping bags of clothes, the baking dish of mangoes, and fresh eggs from the backyard chickens, I laughed to myself how we can't seem to show up at each other's houses without some kind of food offering. And then I thought, isn't that the way it should be? Meal trains, play dates, dinner parties, and hand-me-downs are not proper substitutes for a society that provides affordable childcare, adequate wages, and time for leisure. But these patchwork solutions are precisely how so many of us survive. We will always find a way to take care of each other. When we lean into this natural, unstoppable, and very human urge, the results are expansive. And I want more. I want more friends, more casual impromptu hangs, more dropping by with dinner, more walking and talking and advice sessions, more kids underfoot, more asking for and saying what we need, more hands to carry heavy boxes, more laughing and cackling and snorting, more children farting at the dinner table, more of what makes life messy, less painful, more sweet. I want to give and receive, to always be swapping Tupperware and food, all of us crowded together like curvy lumpen mangoes in a baking dish. Thank you. I'm unmuted now. Am I unmuted?
Am I unmuted? Yes.
Sorry, I don't know why I was looking at you. That's John selling books, but I thought he could solve my microphone issue.
Hello. Okay. Oh, okay.
Hi.
Hi. First of all, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for everyone here being able to come tonight and share space with myself and Angela. I told her that I probably would start crying, and it makes me laugh really hard that I cried before we even got these chairs.
We both cried before when we were backstage, and then obviously I've broken the seal of public crying, so.
I'm honored to be here. I'm honored to be able to talk about this book with you, share family stories and like what community means for you. I think the biggest thing is just seeing your parents here and being so excited that they can be here, and that your husband's here, and your brother, and your family, and your nieces and nephews are here too. I think for me, so much of what we do is really, you know, for them. I want them to know that too. Is. So here we go with the waterworks. This passage, I think, really hit me when, you know, we first were talking about it a little bit earlier, in how similar I feel like my childhood was to yours. How both my parents immigrated to the States, and their instinct was to assimilate. It was to be able to blend in as possible, so that my success would actually be possible.
Yeah.
And I think that, you know, hearing that passage, a lot of that is true. You know, like, my mother was a nurse.
My mother is a nurse.
Yeah. And, you know, the countless hours that they put in for us to be able to go to schools that we probably couldn't go to now.
Yeah, for sure.
And so I think navigating through this book and also your first book, like, when was that moment for you? Hold on, it's in my phone.
Yeah,
the
no,
question. I just got so emotional. The question is, at what point did you see and understand the life and sacrifice your parents did for you and your family? And what was that moment or impact for you moving forward? Because, you know, I know that you grew up in mostly a middle-class white suburb neighborhood.
Yeah. I don't think there was ever just like one particular moment. I have always been, you know, I grew up in a really small town in Pennsylvania that was mostly white. And yeah, the message was assimilate, because that's how you achieve success, right? Like, become legible to white American culture, you know, do really well in school. And those are the things that worked for my parents. You know, they were extremely hardworking. They were also raised in an education system that was created by a colonial American government. So my parents were educated in public schools where they learned English. So my dad speaks three languages. My mom speaks two languages. And part of this benevolent assimilation and part of that colonization was all of this I learned because, I guess I want to say that from a very early age, I've been obsessed with being Filipino. Like, I'm just like, well, we have the best food. Like, our parties are really fun. We have like so much family. But at the same time, I felt really lonely in my Filipino-ness because we didn't have a huge community. And I just didn't, I also saw the way my parents were treated. So I felt like we didn't fit in. And so I grew up feeling really conflicted, like feeling like I'm so deeply proud of who I am, but I'm also like, sometimes, is this me moving this? But I also find myself feeling sometimes ashamed and really confused and really wanting to figure that out. So I think my whole life in some ways has been trying to figure that out. And I definitely think I'm a writer because I was like, I have to do well in school. And then I realized I really liked diagramming sentences and things like that. And it was like a great way to get validation. But I also I really believe that I'm a writer because I feel like I've spent a lot of my time like translating the world to my parents and trying to like explain myself to them. And I think I'm a writer because I just so desperately want to explain myself to them and have them understand like how much I love them and how grateful I am to them, but also how different I feel and how I know I'm so grateful for everything they gave me, but I also know that I needed to live my life on different terms.
Sorry.
So that's, I mean, I think like my whole writing life has been like animated by that desire and that force. And I didn't know it, I think, until later in life. And with my first book, you know, it's meaningful to me because I was writing about, you know, like the science and culture of pregnancy, which is, thank you. Stesha with the assist. You know, I certainly wrote about, there's a real history of oppression within like
the medical system. You know, we experimented on enslaved women in order to like learn how to, you know, for doctors to figure out how to like give birth and deliver babies and repair fistulas and things like that. There's a history of colonial racist violence. But I think I was a little like, oh, I'm writing a pregnancy book to like cater to a lot of people. So I think I held back a little bit.
Yeah.
And with this book, I have just never felt more free. And I never intended to write so much about my family history. But what happened was I was thinking about how I was going to write a history of caregiving in America. That was like my charge. That was what my editor and I discussed. And I was like, how do you write about caregiving in America? It's so complicated. You have to write about enslaved people. And I don't know if I can really tell that story. Like I can do the research. But in the pandemic, there was a statistic that will never leave me. And it was that Filipinx nurses are 4% of the nursing workforce in America. And I should say like that's fairly high because part of the colonial legacy, sorry, I have to explain everything here, but the colonial legacy is that after, the United States created this like farming ground for healthcare workers. They taught people English and they created medical schools and nursing schools. Internally, Americans said that it was because they needed to sanitize people who were inherently unworthy and filthy and needed to be cleansed. So, and then after 1965, when there was a medical worker and nursing shortage, they lifted the quotas from the Philippines for highly skilled workers, which is how my parents came over. That's the system that allowed them to emigrate. So back to the statistic, which is that Filipinx nurses are 4% of the nursing workforce in America, but they are 34% of COVID-related nursing deaths. Yeah, I mean, I think like to sit with that, and I was like, oh, like I thought this could be my mom. This could be your mom. Yeah. This could be the mother of many people I know and love. And it's devastating. And it was like, to me, the statistic was like laid plain, like, these lives are considered less valuable than white lives. And the reason why Filipinx nurses are overrepresented in critical care, which is COVID-19, you know, ICU patients, is because they were willing to take jobs that were more intimate with patients' bodies than white nurses were. So I saw that statistic and I was like, oh, I don't have to tell the story of, African-Americans. I don't have to tell the story of Latinx people who are like disproportionately are house cleaners in America. I can tell my family story, which I don't think enough people know. I don't think we know enough about Filipinx American history, but I can tell it because it's the same forces. It's capitalism and colonialism and white supremacy and racism that like made, that shaped their lives. And so that was sort of my way in. And I feel like I've maybe lost the thread now, but that's how I decided to write about those experiences. And then in writing about mothering, I was humbled to realize that you can't write about mothering and parenting without really reckoning with how you were parented 100%. And how you were mothered. Yeah. And so a lot of this was me figuring out how do I honor what my parents have given me and all of the work that they've done? And how do I also like stay true to who I am, who all of their hard work made it possible for me to be free to be who I am?
Yeah. Thank you. Wow. I think a lot of folks here, obviously your family and friends, but me being just a friend and a colleague, to be able to know the root, right, of where this inspired from. I think oftentimes we don't get to ask that question.
Yeah.
Like, what's the origin story of this? And the fact that these people are here.
I know, it's like really overwhelming.
I know, it makes it even, you know, more special and more incredible. So, do you find that in this journey, your way of being able to write as a way to also share with your parents your experiences? And I, you know, like mom and dad are here, but like that there's healing involved in that as well. I think about how I show up in the restaurant space and how I lead my team. That's my form of communication. Mm-hmm. I am a terrible writer, but I think that I can definitely like show, you know, at least through food, the care that I think you share using your words in the book. And there's moments in time where my parents come in, you know, and they're just, I think when you think about all the sacrifices, you know, like they were nurses, they sacrificed themselves. It was uncomfortable, you know, and then for us and for myself to choose an industry that probably isn't the most favored in the Philippine, you know, culture. But that through me and the success, I guess, and you and your success, that they're able to see it with pride.
I hope so. I mean, I certainly hope so. I think that it's all very imperfect. I think there's healing involved, but like to get to healing, there's hurt.
Yeah.
You know, and I think the thing for me is that there's no, but you don't get anywhere without trying. And I think it's just the thing that like, I'll just always be trying. I think we'll always be trying. And I definitely feel that I express myself like the deepest things through writing. And these are things that I feel like I wish I could say to people, like not just my family, but everyone, you know? And I'm not a not outspoken person, but I find that like the page is where it seems to work best for me. And I think that, yeah, it's all these things that I've been wanting to say. Like I wrote this book in 7 months, which is like ludicrous, but I think there's like an urgency behind it. Cause I think in many ways I've been trying to write this story for a lot of my life. And you know, one of the reasons why I'm so glad that you agreed to be in conversation with me, because, and that Stesha agreed to let this happen. Like, you know, usually when you do an event, you're supposed to have another writer come and talk with you. And that's, there's beautiful things that can come from that. But when I was thinking about it, I was like, I want someone who understands me in a fundamental way. And we have a relationship that's always been like, we just sort of get it. And I think that for you, food is the, like, we have different mediums, yeah. But I think it's exploring what did our childhoods and how we were raised, what's it impart to us? And we want, that's the way that we want to show up in the world, is with our full Filipinx and American identity. And so I wanted, if you don't mind me asking you a question, another reason, like I was really excited that Mel wanted to do this with me, because so a lot of this book is like to take it out of the deeply personal, which I feel so safe, and it's so wonderful to be in Seattle with loved ones, like to have this conversation. But a lot of the book is about how we as a country, we make care work invisible.
Yeah.
We devalue it. We, you know, child care workers are 3 times as likely to live in poverty than workers in any other industry. And we really demand this work of women, and specifically women of color, for free or like poverty wages. And I think it's very shameful. And it's inherently exploitative and racist. And so the care industry, it turns out, is not so different from the restaurant industry, or like the traditional model of the restaurant industry, which runs on the invisible work of workers of color, many of them immigrants. And it really sort of vanishes the team effort of running a restaurant, and like likes to lionize and celebrate an individual or a chef. And so the thing that I love about Mel and admire her about her so much is that she has chosen not to follow that restaurant model, which is difficult to do. But you know, everyone on Mel's team gets health insurance and has a 401k and has, which is like a really big deal. Like to me, it's just an example that, you know, we can have more humane labor systems. We can have a more humane culture if we choose to have one. And I wondered if you could just talk about that decision to do that, and what's hard about it, and why you do that, and what are the, I'd just love for you to talk about it.
Thank you. I mean, gosh, like just hearing you name off the things about caretaking, and it's like, if you just replace that word with restaurant worker,
yeah,
it's the same thing.
Yes,
in a sense. And I think,
and these are really the jobs that like make our economy go.
Exactly.
Like, that's the other thing. Service and care are really the everyday things that make our lives convenient and possible.
And I was thinking about that because I was reading how we take our own, like we will work to pay someone else take care of our child, but we should really be spending time. And that's the essence of this. And it's like people hire cooks or go to restaurants
but don't even think about the people that are serving or even like cooking the food. They're just there because it's like, this person is famous or they're cooking this for me. And they don't ever like take time to even think about the back, like the backbone to what mm-hmm. makes this operation work. There's a lot of familiar faces here for me too. And I think many of us at some point in our life have either served tables or worked in this industry or experienced the toxicity that it entails. And I think for me, just the fact that like I had such a strong parental like and familial unit surrounding me, like my parents worked every day, you know, my mom worked graveyard, and like you express that loneliness, like I felt that too in Philippine culture. Like you were left at a very early age, probably mm-hmm. a lot earlier than like most children now. But I was grateful that I had this like cousin unit that like we raised each other. And so the idea of community was super instilled from the beginning. So that I think my journey into the restaurant world, I was so like taken aback mm-hmm. by how individualistic and like how competitive and how like singular gold people are without trying to help each other boost up. How people yeah. would, you know, take advantage or throw people under the bus. And you're like, well, this isn't the way that I want to operate. Like,
yeah.
this isn't the way that like I was taught or I experienced. And so it's taking that personal experience and, you know, I guess shaking the system in a very like traditional set kitchen way.
Yeah.
To be like, we can change.
Yeah. I mean, I think about how, I mean, because I worked as a food writer and I reported on restaurants and I mean, people really showed their whole, yeah. keep it family friendly, you know, when $15 an hour was happening, where people like, people were very resistant to that, right? And everyone would always say, you know, the restaurant industry runs on very slim margins. And that's true. But I also was like, but you still make a profit. Like you can still do that. And like, the thing is, I think you have a, like, it takes courage and it takes, I also think it's, the experience that you bring to it to be like, I've seen like exploitation, I've seen like the way hard way that people work, and I don't want it to be that way. But that's like a brave, like, and like visionary, I think, sort of decision to make.
Yeah.
When I interviewed Mel a couple of years ago for an article in Bon Appetit, and she was telling me about, you know, the benefits and the things that workers get, but how you can you talk about the team meeting that yeah. you have?
Yeah. I mean, I think like so much of like if in the kitchen world, especially, it's like you have a prep list, you say, yes, chef, you keep your head down and you follow, like zero personality, zero sense of like ownership of who you are, like you're a cog in the system. And so when I opened Musang, it was super important for me that was not the case, that my team had the opportunities to develop their palates, to find their personalities, to be able to share that as well. And we formed a leadership team that, you know, we opened in January of 2020. And, you know, I think you spend so much of your life planning and plotting and hoping that you achieve this child in a yeah. sense, like that's born into this world that's like, what the hell just happened yeah. to us? And the pandemic, you know, in all of its period, like yeah. gave me the opportunity to really think and reflect on like, how do I want to show up in this space differently? And so we formed this leadership team, and also with my team, we meet, you know, weekly, we meet monthly, and it's not just a checkup of how the business is doing, it's about how my team is doing. I think sometimes we forget that people are human and that they have needs, they have sadness, they have things that like can either show up into the workplace, but if we can provide a way where they're heard, seen, and listened to, that we can create space for them to like be able to heal as well. And it's shocking for a lot of people. A lot of people when they first start with us are like, what is this? Like, right. I have to share my feelings. But all in all, like the kind of like camaraderie that is formed, that trust that is formed is so incredible. And like, yeah. And, you know, like, I think we're ever evolving, you know, like, I think that's one thing that I think restaurateurs can hopefully like understand too, that like whatever the past was is not set in stone anymore.
Yeah. Like, yeah. And I mean, that's the sort of that parallel to speak to that is that I feel like the pandemic revealed like this, we talk about the childcare crisis in America, but the childcare crisis predated the pandemic.
Yeah.
You know, until your child is six, you're on your own and everyone's just like left to figure it out. And you do nanny shares and you like, you know, it's true. Like a year of preschool costs more than a lot of college tuitions.
Yeah.
Like for a year, and that's it, like bankrupts people. And so in the pandemic, you know, women and mothers, there's 2 million less women in the workforce today than there were at the start of the pandemic. And when schools were closed in the fall of 2020, 865,000 women dropped out, no, sorry, did not drop out, were forced out of the workforce by these conditions in 1 month. And that's because, you know, schools were closed. And so, and that was a time too, when people who are financially privileged enough to outsource care work to nannies and babysitters, again, mostly women of color, when they weren't able to come to the home, a lot of affluent and white women were like, oh, like I have leaned in and yet here I am like having to like figure out childcare. Like, and this is not what I was promised, right? And so we realized that like this sort of like what passes for a care structure in our country is actually, it's just like sticks and tape, right? Like,
absolutely.
And so I think that sort of anger that I saw, part of why I wanted to write this book was because I was like, I don't want us to forget this moment.
100%.
Yeah. And yeah. So things, and now as we're all like, it's okay, we don't need to wear masks anymore. It's okay, go back to work, go back to the office, right? Let's go back to normal, whatever that is. I think I've seen like at least within the parenting and motherhood space, people are like kind of like, okay, like it's not so bad. Like we're growing, like I have my babysitter again, I have my nanny again. And I think like I think it's the same thing. The thing is for us, I just feel like it's like, this has been exposed and I won't shut up about this, right?
Yeah,
like,
absolutely.
It's like, I can't like not, like this is, we still have so much work to do. And I see that sort of potential. You know, I reject all silver linings of the pandemic. There's too much grief and death and loss, but it has revealed things that I think are really clarifying, you know, and to me, like the value of care, the value of your workers and seeing people fully for who they are, we can't see them as invisible and like and that's replaceable. Like,
and if we need to be the voices for that, which I feel called, and I think you feel called 100%, like, so be it, because
it's funny. I mean, I'm like, yeah, I mean, there's lots of, I'm like, but we're here. Yeah, so let's say that we're called to do this. Yeah.
And like, in that sense,
I'll take
like,
that. Yeah.
And it's hard, you know, it's not easy work, but
yeah,
I feel like, being able to share, I don't know, that's where it starts. Right.
So, yeah.
I know the time is of essence, but, I think maybe if it's cool, we can take some questions from the audience.
Totally.
Or folks online, because we also want to honor that you guys, I'm sure, have lots of questions for Angela.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you for, I feel like Mel and I were just having a heart to heart.
Oh, yeah. Thank you for being part of her.
Oh, what a pleasure to get to listen to that. So for folks here in the room, if you have questions and want to write them on the index cards that we passed out at the beginning, I'll come and collect them. And if you didn't get an index card but would like one, you can raise your hand and I'll bring you one. And for folks online, just pop your question in the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen. I will take a moment and share. We got some beautiful comments after your initial reading. Angela, people said, that was incredible. I'm not crying. You're crying. so glad to be here and learning. I wish I were in the room, but I'm glad to be part of this. It says, yes, Kimball in the house. What an amazing community we're all part of. So I just wanted to share those. So many comments. People are with you, even though they're not in the room, they're part of the community. So folks, do we have questions? I see one. I'll be right there. And Mel, if you maybe have one more question.
Oh, yeah. More questions. Yeah, as I sit here and wait. What's next?
Because everyone asks me that question all the time.
Right, yeah.
And I'm like, I'm still right here.
Right. It's the worst question.
It's also like, I want to, manifest. Yeah, it's so sweet.
My daughter, Noli, who is there, she, the other day we were at the dining room table and she just turned to me and she goes, Mama, what are your goals? And I was like, excuse me? And she was like, do you have a goal for how many books you want to write in your life? And I was like, girl, it is too early for this question. the book just came out.
Yeah.
And I feel honestly like I'm still recovering from writing it.
Yeah.
And then I'm like touring now. And so I don't know. I do want to keep writing. And the things that I'm really drawn to right now, I can say this much, are... So like this book is predominantly about caring for children. It's also, I'm trying to expand it into, just care, how we value care in our society. Yeah. And so I don't want to, in my future work, I don't want to privilege one kind of caregiving over another. Like I'm thinking about elder care. I'm thinking about how we care for people who are disabled. I'm thinking like how we honestly just reimagine our institutions so that they actually care about people,
yes.
Right? Like we call it healthcare, but really it's a profit. Machine, yeah. Right? Like we've really sort of like made human rights negotiable and we've privatized them. So just exploring care and like an expansive definition of care and like, how can we motivate, is it possible to motivate people who don't want to have children to like have, it's really beautiful having relationships with young people. Like, you know this, you don't have children.
Yeah.
You have a restaurant where you care for a lot of people and you are a wonderful auntie, right?
Yeah.
Like, but like, how could we maybe get people to want to do that? Like, can we give them a tax break if they like take care of kids, right? Or if you like visit old people like in a nursing home, right? Like, I'm interested in things like that. And then the other thing I'm really interested in is middle age, because I am. And and I feel like in the last 5 years I look at myself and I'm like, wow, I look so much older, my body is so much older, and I resent that slightly, but at the same time I after so many, my whole life, like I don't feel confused about who I am.
Yes.
Like I know who I am. And so, and I think I didn't really, I imagined myself making it to 40 and then maybe being 65, but I never thought about this period of my life that I'm in. And so I think it's really interesting, but there's not a lot of literature for middle-aged women to think about like this like period of transformation in your life. And I think it's really powerful. So yeah. So those are the things I'm thinking about.
Good.
But I'm going to take August off and not do anything.
Absolutely.
So that's what's really next to me.
Right. So we have some questions.
Okay.
How and where did you get the idea for the book? Which is, we kind of touched on that earlier.
Yeah. I mean, I'll say like the sort of, I mean, one other thing like to just sort of frame it is I was under contract to write a book. I was like, over a year late on this book. And then I was going to be a year late because the pandemic happened and we were with our children 24/7 for 4 months. And I was like, this is not gonna happen. And I was feeling a lot of loss and sadness around that. But also I was thinking about how care work was so important. And I knew that it was the most important thing I could be doing, like keeping my kids safe, keeping my community safe. And I remember thinking early on, like we're hearing about all of these essential workers, right? We're hearing about healthcare workers, we're hearing about sanitation workers, like, and yes, they are essential. But I also was like, what about me? Like, what about moms?
Yeah.
What about parents? Like, I am working all the time and this feels pretty essential. So that was kind of like the seed of like when I really started to think about how do I want to write about care work. And I want to write about mothering and how I make meaning from something that feels like drudgery, but I know is very important, you know, that this is like the basic work of being a person is caring for yourself and caring for others. Yeah, to be clear, I believe the only real work of humans is care and keeping yourself alive. Like, yeah.
Yes. What is your favorite page in the book?
Page? Well, I don't know if I have a favorite page specifically, but I like this question because also, I mean, it's kind of a long book, so I haven't figured that out yet. I'll say that my favorite chapter that I loved writing And that I almost read from tonight, though, is called Mothering is Encouraging Appetites, because I got to write a lot about Filipino food. Mm. And I got to write a lot about like being comfortable taking up space, like literally and figuratively, like in my body and in a room. And that's really what I want for my children. But I also really like the other pages I really like are the acknowledgments, because it's where you get to like write your love letters and thank yous to the people who made the work possible. And I'm the kind of person that I read the acknowledgments first in any book that I get.
Yeah. We want to know those people.
Yeah.
All right. So let's see. The title of your book is Essential Labor. You talked about that label in terms of Filipinx nurses specifically. Could you speak more in depth about how your book challenges or expands the label essential labor in the time of COVID, especially in light of the invisibility of certain kinds of care?
Yeah. So I think that we tend to think, again, in this country, because we tie things like healthcare, again, human rights, to having a job. You know, like, I think that everyone is born worthy and deserving of a life that is comfortable, that has like pleasure and ease built into it. And people are really scared of that idea. I think people with money really need to think that they somehow are better or did something to deserve it. And the fact is, like, in this country, many people didn't, right? And so for me, I want to challenge people to realize that we think of our homes as private refuges, right? And they are, they're where we go for comfort, but they have always been sites of work, right? Like, especially if we think about in this country, the history of slavery, right? Especially for Black women and women of color, they have always been working in the home, whether they were compensated or not. And so when women, you know, when feminism was like, go find meaning outside of the home, that's great for some people, but it never, again, care work never went away.
Yeah.
And so what we did was really, we outsourced that to women of color, like very cheaply. And so I just want everyone to realize, like, despite what our country tells us, that domestic labor is essential. Without it, none of us would be here. Without it, none of us would have jobs. Mm-hmm. You know, if you don't have a meal and like a way to shower, right? And a way to like think of yourself as a worthy person, then you're not gonna be able to show up and do anything in the world, whether it's professionally or like for your community. So yes, like I think that COVID, you know, in that specific pandemic lens, when we were all like scrambling, when like care networks fell apart, it was really clear the only work that really mattered was getting through each day.
I really love like that in the passage that you read of like, I am able to give my daughter's community and like mentorship and this, but like, I don't know if I can get them braces or,
right.
You know, and like, I think that's so important to even just like see that, like, where is our value and what has like, yeah. This like society as a whole shown us that like, well, this is more important or valuable for your children, yeah. When at the end in the pandemic, like it was getting through day by day, yeah. Being with who you could be in whatever space or capacity,
yeah.
It is, and like what you're giving them and the legacy that you're giving them.
And I mean, I understand it's hard. Like I have a level of comfort that I can give up, you know, yeah. And that's entirely because of my parents and their love and their work. And I know that that's harder for other people. I know that like choosing to like, or accepting some downward mobility, it's easier for me than it is for others. But it also means that there's other people who can, I think we really have to understand that if we're gonna care for everyone, like sacrifices will have to be made. You know what I mean? Like we will have to give up some sort of comfort and we will have to really reckon with our priorities. And it's scary to think about doing that. And I worry for my kids. Like I want them to have, like I had such a wonderful, comfortable life. But if I give them nothing else, like the thing that my parents gave me was unconditional love. And I know that if I can give that to them, then I don't know, we'll figure other things out, I guess, you know? maybe they won't want to go to college. That's fine. It doesn't make you morally superior to have a private education.
I think that's where my mom, our parents would come in and help.
Any advice for another Filipina, Filipinx going into an alternative career path?
Oh, I'm not really good at advice. So I'm not, the thing I'll just say is like, I just be really clear about who you are, you know? Like, I think that the work of like the work of my life is like, knowing who I am and like not being confused, knowing what's important to me, right? And what are the things that I would be willing to give up to sort of like piggyback onto that conversation. I just think, I don't know, like it could be really hard, but it's also like, I think betting on yourself and investing in yourself is, I don't know, well, my therapist told me this. And she's smart. And she was like, that's the thing. Like, you're never going to regret that. And it's the thing that will pay dividends. And I think, like, you can, I think if there's that Erykah Badu song where it's like, the lyric is, guess I was born to make mistakes, but I ain't scared to take the weight. And like, that's my advice. Listen to Erykah Badu.
We love that. What are your strategies for channeling your anger into positive action?
Hey, Lagaya, how are you? Are you bored?
How do you not let anger drown you?
Oh, this is a really good question. And this, I actually got this question the other day. And as someone who has struggled with anger issues throughout her life and still does to a certain extent, I've like done a lot of work on this. Like what I would say is that anger is gonna come, like I accept it. But anger, it takes so much energy to stay angry. And maybe it was like being destroyed by two children like in the early days. Like I just don't have that energy to spare. And so I think about how energy is like, it's the law of the universe that energy cannot be killed, right? It is transformed. And so I do a lot of thinking about how to transform the anger that I have into something constructive. And there's a book that I read at the beginning of the pandemic called Minor Feelings, An Asian American Reckoning by Kathy Park Hong, which I recommend to everyone. But this is a woman who like has definitely accepted anger as like a driving force behind her art. And it's so powerful. Like she has just taken her anger and like honed it into this sharpest tool that just like eviscerates like every idea you have about like who Asian people are and like what the expectations of us are. And I saw that and I was like, I want to do that. I want to try to do that. And so I think like, I can't stop myself from being angry. And also there is so much to be angry about right now.
Yeah.
Like I will not deny anyone their anger. I think it's just about, I got to a point where I felt like my anger will destroy me if I don't figure out a place to put it or something to put it into. And so, I mean, a lot of my work is driven by that.
Yeah. What tensions have you felt with assimilation in the field of writing? And how did you marry together your personal identity with your profession? Do you ever feel that you're too Filipina for white spaces and also not Filipina enough?
I don't know. I mean, whoever wrote this question obviously lives rent-free in my mind. This is like the thing that I felt throughout my life.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, yep. And I think that I'm guessing maybe the person who wrote it is Pinay, and I think you already know. Like, that is a central tension of my life, to feel in so many ways not Filipino, Filipina enough. And then to know, to have known from the very beginning of my life that I would never fit in fully in white culture, you know, like the extent to which I can code switch without thinking about it, that to the extent that I don't even know what's happening, the extent to which, like, I think I'm a writer because, like those rules of grammar, like I've really grappled with it where I'm like, is this some rule some white guy made up? Yeah. Like, like this is not, I'm not smarter. I'm not better. for being a good writer. And so I think that that's, I don't know, that all of that is there. And like to be, like I got asked a question in an interview that was like, do you think like publishing is changing when like your book can come out and there's an incredible writer who I admire and named Danny McLean, who wrote a great book called We Live for the We, The Political Power of Black Motherhood. And they were like, you know, you've written these books and do you think publishing is changing? And I was like, I wanna think so, but the truth is that like Danny and I both went to like the same university and we are like deeply legible to like gatekeepers in white American culture. So no, it hasn't really changed that much because like we are what has been deemed acceptable.
Yes.
So I think that like, but to the extent, like the way that I think about it is like, I have this chance, like I've been called into this place and like, I'm not gonna blow it. I'm gonna talk about it. The more that I'm fortunate to have success in a platform, the more, I mean, like this book is, it's definitely like, as I was writing it, I'm like, can white women like get on our level? Like
questions like, is publishing changing? Is the, you know, kind of current temperature, I guess, and like culinary, is that changing? Why is it that the James Beard Award this year had so many more people of color, where in the past, like they had zero?
Yeah.
And so, I mean, to be vocal about it in the why too, like I feel that 100%.
Yeah, I mean, like, things are changing.
Yeah.
Not fast enough.
Yeah.
But they're changing not because, I mean, let's face it, like they didn't change because people were like, suddenly I feel, I feel like this is the right thing. It's because like, what is it? It's a power concedes nothing without demand, right? And so like that sort of like the uprisings, the summer of 2020, right? Like, and you know, the James Beard Award, like structurally, let's also name like they dropped it, application fees for first time applicants, right? Like there are so many structural barriers. And so I think it's important, like we have to call out what those structural barriers are and yes. So I think like, I've come to a place where I'm like pretty, I'm fairly comfortable. Like I can't, I'm almost 45. So I like the extent to like, I act the way I act out of internalized whiteness. Like, I don't know, but I don't think I'm going to change who I am at this point. Like I sort of accept that. And I'm like, I'm someone who, like, it's interesting to me, like, I've been interviewed by a lot of white women who are like, I feel so seen by your book. And I'm like, cool. Like, I'm really, like, I'm really glad. Like, I feel like I did the thing so that you can, like, the misery of the early pandemic is really, and what caregivers and mothers have had to go through is not racially specific, right?
No,
like,
absolutely.
It's, and so I'm like, great. Like, I made it so that you could see yourself. But then I'm also like, can you,
the second part,
can you see yourself in the women that I'm writing about?
Yeah.
Can you see yourself in like your nanny? Can you see yourself in your childcare provider? And that's kind of the next step.
Yeah.
And I feel like I'm in a place where if people are listening and white people, like white women, like feel safe and identify with me, then I'm like, I think I can, again, like just sort of like drive it forward a little bit.
Yeah.
And you know, if not, why not me?
Exactly.
I didn't hear that.
Oh, she's all the way over there.
Now.
Oh, you can go see John Doe. He's up there. Hi. Yeah, it's okay.
Hey, Mel.
All right.
Mel.
Yes.
I have a question here from the audience.
Yes.
Online, if that's online. Okay. I'll pop in. This is from Amy. It says, hi, Angela. I'm the single mom of a teen daughter in Port Angeles, Washington. I've just begun writing a memoir and essays. I would love to know about your writing practice. Like, is it scheduled or more free flow? And do you do it every day? Thank you. I feel inspired.
Oh, great. I'm glad you feel inspired. I have no, well, right now I feel like the idea of writing anything else feels like impossible and slightly like violence against me. So I'm like not writing right now. And I would start, you know, one thing I would say is that like, it's okay to have like periods of like fallowness and not feeling inspired. The thing that I would say, I want to like shout out my husband, Will, who's here, that the reason, the reason I got this book done is because Will was like, go away. And he like pulled up a Google calendar and was like, he was like, for the next 6 months, like every 3 weeks, you're gonna go away for like 3 days or 4 days or a week. And like, I'll just take care of it. And, you know, we have the help of my parents, we had the help of Becca and John Doe, but that was really important. I went away, you know, I went to like cabins, Airbnbs, a house sat, did various things. And so time and space, I know, I'm guessing for Angie, it's probably hard to come by. So in that circumstance, I would also say that like, the last thing you need is like another obligation or to feel like it's a thing you have to do. And so I think one of the things that's, there's this poet that I follow, his newsletter, his name is Yanyi. And he has this idea of like in a world that always like expects something from you, like make your creativity and your practice like a garden that you expect nothing from, but that you still tend to, right? So it's like kind of like getting in touch, like just sort of like touching like your creative self a little bit every day and nurturing that and then beginning to make space for that and thinking of yourself in that way. I think that's a good place to start.
Any other questions? Thank you. I have one more question from the online audience. I think it's pronounced maybe Sharissa. Says, I once saw Angela and her family at a restaurant in our neighborhood and was geeking out. Angela, how do you like to interact with your fans? Oh, we want to share our enthusiasm and love, but be respectful of your boundaries.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the social boundaries and that kind of stuff.
They want to share their enthusiasm and love, but also be respectful of your boundaries.
Yeah, no, that's such a nice question. And I'm still like, hi, Lindy. I'm still, I feel like it's like figuring that out. I don't know. Like it's a new thing for me to like have fans. So I don't know. I mean, like, yeah, I'm just like a person with my family out at the restaurant. So I feel like, I think like general rules of, you know, being polite and nice. If my child is like having a breakdown, maybe not the best time to say hi, you know, like, so it's, I think it's just sort of common sense. I will say like, I love hearing from people. I love connecting with people. I genuinely, it's like what feeds me. And it's so meaningful to me to hear from people. Like, you know, there's no writer who doesn't like that and have positive affirmation. And I think the thing that I've figured out though, to be honest, and boundaries, and this is another thing that middle age is good for. I feel like I want to be there with you in that moment. I want to like connect with you and say thank you and receive the love that you have to give me. And then and then we're gonna have that moment, and then the moment's gonna be over, and I'm gonna go back to my life. You know, like I think that it's really, I'm so grateful that I get to have these really meaningful moments with people. But that's not what my real life is. My real life is like taking care of, taking people to the bathroom, and like making sure that like the check is paid and that kind of thing. If that, I hope that's a good answer.
I think so. Now the crowd online is talking about all the times they've seen you. I love it.
Yes.
I'll share that with you later. I think we have time for maybe one more question and then we'll go to our book signing.
Okay.
In your reading, you mentioned social circles shrinking, but relationships with fewer people deepening. Can you talk more about that phenomenon? Either what you observed in your own life or research on the impacts of the pandemic. Thank you both.
Yeah. I would also be interested in your answer to this question. If you do you want to answer that?
I'm sure your answer.
I mean, I just think about how your team shrank.
Yeah.
I mean, could you
would
you be willing to sure. like answer it a little bit? Because yeah, I think that's a really interesting and I'm willing to answer it as well. But yeah.
I mean, I think one thing for sure that like occurred in the pandemic was like, one, I wanted to keep my parents safe. So that was really difficult. Jonah, who's my sous chef, we hopefully have seen on our Instagram, is wonderful, but her and I made that decision early on in the pandemic that we would be the only ones in the restaurant so that we could take care of our team. Mm-hmm. A lot of my team lived with their parents as well. And it was important that like that intergenerational kind of family unit was safe. And so that was huge. You know, there was a sense of loneliness, 100% of making that sacrifice that we talk about for care. But it also showed us and very like-minded people that were doing the work that we were doing with the community kitchen, mm-hmm. that we could break bread with still, that we could like really talk about how we wanted to change the industry.
Yeah.
Alex, who's here too.
Yeah.
We met virtually. On a board talking about ways that we could find solutions to things that were breaking. And I think that the people that I hold close
and dear and now to me. It's not so much like being in this industry, you're like, you know, everyone, it's like my time is precious.
Yeah.
And I want to guard that. And so when I choose to spend it and how I choose to spend it with those people are much more intentional.
Yeah.
And I think that's where that deepening is. It's like an intentional purpose to when you show up into a space versus just knowing a lot of people.
Yeah. Yeah. I think like, you know, 20-year-old us.
Oh yeah.
Was like, got a name.
Like, here. Let's get seen.
Right. And now I'm like,
yep. 100%.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I wrote about this in the book, you know, we had like one of the great like gifts of my life is that we got really close to the Chase Chens, and who are here and who I love so much. That was unexpected. It was like, it started from a need, and then it was a really beautiful, just natural deepening. And now I really like, as things start to open back up, like we've had these conversations where we've been like, it's been 2 weeks since we've seen you. Like, I don't want to stop seeing you. But one of the things that happened within that too is that like, so three of my friends here, like we didn't see my other friends as much. And that was like out of necessity, and I missed them so much. And I think about how now like I don't want to go back. And I think like that deepening of care or whatever, for me, it's like, I don't know, like the condition of being a person, like for me is like, I keep needing people. Like, I'm never gonna stop, and I want to like take care of people. And what I've realized is that like I can have all of those things, you know, I'm never gonna stop needing. And it's not I think there's so much love and affection and care, and it can be spread around. I was talking to someone who they also had like a very, very deep close relationship they developed with someone, with another family in the pandemic. And they were like, but now, like, I think that family is a little more scheduled. So they're like, now they go to soccer practice, now they go to dance, and like, we don't see them as much. And she was like, I really miss them. I miss needing them. And I was like, I hear that. And I was like, but you know, you can still need them. Like,
yeah.
And you can need other people. And I bet there are other people who want to spend time with you and your wife and your kids. And like, that sort of thing is like, I want us to, if there's like a final thing to say, I think there's a lot of that sort of connectedness and community that all of us have discovered that we need in the pandemic, and the pandemic that is still ongoing. But I just don't want us to lose that. I want us to move forward and like take that and figure out ways to like continue doing it and spread it around. Because there is like, this is what I said in that reading, like it turns out like we all have a lot more to give, I think, than we realize. And there are many people who want to give to us more than we realize. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
That is such a beautiful place to end for tonight. Thank you so much.
Thank you for that beautiful conversation. Thank you all for being here tonight. And for our online audience, we had a little technical difficulty there, but we made it through. So we're grateful for everybody's patience there. Elliott Bay Book Company have copies of Angela's books right at the table to your right there. And so if folks are here in the auditorium and would like to get a book signed, Angela will be signing at that white table at the front of the auditorium. We're requesting that you stay masked in the signing line. And if you can line up so that the line comes across the auditorium here in front of the podium, that will be the least chaotic for folks. And then if you're heading out, please exit through the 4th Avenue lobby, which is behind me. You can drop surveys in the basket on the table with the blue tablecloth. And for folks watching from home, you can find the link for the survey in the chat and copies of Angela's books at elliottbaybook.com. Thank you so much to everybody who made tonight's program possible. Thank you to Wing Luke Museum and Elliott Bay Book Company and our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, and the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Thanks to all of you for joining us tonight. We'll see you next time.